used by him was that we agreed to build a nuclear power station at Bushehr. And that may be one of the best examples of how countries can use nuclear energy for peaceful purposes without violating non-proliferation regime. Russia builds a power station, Russia supplies enriched uranium to produce electric power, and then the used fuel is taken back by Russia and brought back to Russia. So Iran has, as a result, energy produced through a nuclear power station, but Iran doesn't have technology for processing and enriching uranium, which is safe from the point of view of non-proliferation. So we're going to see what will happen next. They're very hard negotiators. In a few days, there will be another international meeting in London of this group, EU3+3. They will come up with new ideas of dialogue, discussions, possibility of another resolution in the UN Security Council. So it is a very important matter. I think today, it's, along with the Kosovo, it's one of the most burning international issues. As far as war games, I don't see clearly what you meant. If you meant these reports of strategic bombers flying, overflying the Arctic, well, I don't see how it can change the strategic, geostrategic situation, since there have been never any restrictions for the flights, and actually Russia has stopped the flights of strategic bombers simply because at that stage, in the beginning of the 90s, we didn't have money to run the program. Now we have, we need to train pilots, we need to maintain this part of strategic arsenal of the Russian Federation. And of course, as has been reported, those planes, they do not carry nuclear weapons, but they need to continue to fly. As Americans continue to do it, they never actually stopped doing that. So I think we should not consider that as from the point of view of rivalry of the Cold War. It's a new situation. We are not enemies, we are partners, and but on the other side, there are some concerns. We're also concerned by plans of deploying entire missile system in the Czech Republic and in Poland, which, as we see it, have no justification from the point of view that those deployment cannot be aimed against North Korean missiles, or it's highly problematic that it can deal with Iranian threat, since Iran doesn't possess and missiles of such range that can be intercepted. But we can see that there is a real threat for the. For the Russian strategic infrastructure from this position. So that's why we're discussing that with the Americans, and we hope we're going to find a solution very quietly, with no confrontation, trying to reach a consensus. As far as the military spending, yes, because the situation was appalling. Even now, the military spending of Russia is a small fraction of the military budget, not only of the United States, but also of Britain. And we need to increase military spending, because the government needs to pay decent salaries to officers, soldiers, to acquire new equipment, to update technology. We have no intention to maintain, we do not have resources for that, and we do not have interest to have a huge army as the Soviet Union had in the past, but this small army should be high-tech army, And if it is a high-tech army, it is using all these gizmos and equipment that are used now everywhere in the world. Of course, it is not cheap, it is quite expensive. That's why spending are going up, but still, we are not competing with military expenses of important Western powers.
Thank you.
You serve the mic.
Do you think Russia is likely to have its own colored revolution, as we saw in Georgia and Ukraine?
I think Russia already had its color revolution, even two in the beginning of the 90s. So we were the first, and the others followed us. So I don't think it is a realistic scenario for Russia because of overall stabilization, the growth of the middle class, business activities, it is very unlikely.
I just wanted to check, in terms of political culture, I know you've mentioned it briefly before, I just wanted to check, I know a lot of leaders, especially in the CIS, such as President Obama and Haydar Mukhelia before him, they often brought up the subject that their lack of democratization is because it's a negative political culture, that people don't understand what democracy is. And so I know they continuously use this as an excuse in countries like Azerbaijan, but they're still being authoritarian.
I would not speak for the Azerbaijan or for any other country of the former Soviet Union. Conditions are quite different, and I will give only one example. You know what happened in Uzbekistan 2 years ago in Andijan. There have been riots, and those riots were fueled by Muslim fundamentalists. And the government used force to stop these riots. People were killed. It's very unfortunate. So what to do? It's a very hard dilemma. On one hand, people were killed, and of course the government of Uzbekistan was criticized by all European governments. There have been sanctions which were imposed against Uzbekistan. On the other side, they succeeded. Maybe they did it the wrong way, but they succeeded to curb the fundamentalist movement in Uzbekistan, which would be much more dangerous alternative for this particular country. So situation in different parts of the former Soviet Union is quite different. It is determined by social, cultural, political, economic, historical, and other factors. As far as Russia is concerned, the Russian option for democracy is irreversible. They may be different understanding, different concepts of democracy, but the basic concept is that this should be the democratic system that could be supported by people. If this particular political system, this kind of democracy, this culture of democracy, which exists in Russia and which is evolving in Russia, because it is not the final project, the situation is still evolving, if it is supported by people, so it is a democratic system.
Thank you. The gentleman.
Yes, thank you. I wondered if you could speak a little bit about economic diversification.